WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Erek Barron has served as a trial attorney in the United States Department of Justice's Criminal Division, where there he handled regional and national gang and organized crime investigations and prosecutions. Then, Bryan Nehman in the audience, he served as counsel and policy advisor to then United States Senator Joe Biden on the United States Senate Judiciary Committee's Subcommittee on Crime and Drugs, where there he focused on law enforcement, crime policy, and oversight of the United States Department of Justice. Well, now he joins us as the 49th United States Attorney for the District of Maryland, the first African-American in that spot. And by the way, Bryan, he got a unanimous vote. They don't do anything unanimous anymore.
Yes,
United States Senate to get this position. United States Attorney Erek Barron, first of all, Happy New Year and good morning to you.
Good morning, Bryan. Good morning, C4. Happy New Year. It's a pleasure to be with you all.
Great to have you on.
Thank you very much. We'll get to some of the other things public policy-wise that you have done before coming to this office, U.S. Attorney Erek Barron. But let me ask you, your vision, you met with some reporters yesterday and outlined kind of who you are. What is your vision as you take over this office of United States Attorney?
So my vision really is about, you know, getting back to basics, taking care of what is an excellent office. I am fortunate enough to be entering into a team that is great. The office is running well. The people are extremely talented. But like any other office during this pandemic, you know, folks have been, you know, dealing with, you know, the COVID-19 crisis and such. And so I've been meeting with each and every person within the office and getting a good assessment of what we're doing, what our status is, you know, any tweaks and improvements that might be made, what we're doing well, and what we can double down on. So really, first, it's about the people within the office, taking care of the people so that then we can take care of the priorities that we have.
All right. So what are the priorities do you see in our state and in your office to try and take care of?
So certainly it starts with violent crime, particularly in Baltimore City. And, you know, I would say throughout the state and the country, there's been certainly a significant uptick in violent crime. And the city in particular has, you know, seen what its seventh year above 300 homicides and other violent crimes. So we got to, you know, get a handle on that together, first and foremost, but also white-collar crime, fraud against, you know, vulnerable populations, especially the elderly, civil rights violations, national security and cybercrime, and, you know, of course, the office continues to prosecute public corruption.
We're speaking with United States Attorney Erek Barron. And U.S. Attorney Barron, you have served as an assistant state's attorney in Prince George's County, Baltimore City. You are primarily looking at violent crime. Governor Hogan, with your predecessors, has set up a relationship of putting some attorneys in your office to assist in looking at Baltimore City specifically, but really helping out with violent crime. Do you want to continue that? Do you want to have, you know, that type of state, a U.S. attorney partnership type of thing?
Absolutely. That continues to this day. Those attorneys, those special assistant U.S. attorneys, are an extremely important part of our priorities, particularly dealing with violent crime and part of our Project Safe Neighborhoods program and initiative. And I've had conversations with the governor's office and look forward to meeting with the governor personally in the next couple of weeks to maybe see how we can improve and double down on that partnership.
Well, I was curious because obviously, you know, we've seen crime spike in a lot of cities across America, and here in Baltimore, it's been consistently high for the last 7 years. Has there been any memo or any kind of directive from the U.S. attorney about the focus on crime and murders, especially attempted murders? Is that part of the focus, or is every, you know, jurisdiction different?
Well, it certainly is part of the focus of the U.S. Department of Justice generally, and there was a pretty comprehensive memo that came down over the summer from the Deputy Attorney General about our focus as a general matter and getting back to what is a proven strategy over the decades, Project Safe Neighborhoods. And so what that means for Maryland is really you know, kind of taking a step back and focusing on not just, you know, exile, but Project Safe Neighborhoods generally, and, you know, what has been in the past a pretty successful program. And so for our office, that means, you know, really a three-pronged approach, you know, enforcement and, accountability, one, two, prevention through community and youth outreach, and three, prevention through reentry and support for returning citizens. And so I think in each category, we have plenty of room to step it up, and we'll be doing that. You know, this office will be looking to take, in a targeted way, more gun cases. We'll be looking to be out in the community more. We'll be focusing on, you know, repeat violent offenders and getting them off the street by any legal means necessary. And, you know, we'll be continuing to do the things that we're doing with long-term investigations with the strike force.
We're speaking with Maryland United States Attorney Erek Barron, his first time on the show with us, Bryan. And I'll let Bryan ask you a deeper question. I'm getting ready to ask you now because I know he wants to wade a little deeper than I will. But without getting into the specifics of the indictment of State's Attorney Marilyn Mosby, your office has to work with the Baltimore City State's Attorney's Office in order to achieve many of the things you're talking about, particularly around violent crime in the city. Can you just tell our audience that regardless of what else is going on, that your offices are continuing that process, U.S. Attorney Barron?
Absolutely. Look, we have our challenges, and we always have some challenges, but we have solid working relationships with all of our partners, including the Baltimore City State's Attorney's Office.
All right. So, but if you have, you've indicted, obviously, the state's attorney, does that change the dynamic, the working relationship at all with that office at this point?
That office, and as C4 said, I worked in that office, and many of the people I worked with are still there or connected with that office. It's an office full of, you know, hardworking professional public servants, and that working relationship, the work that they do and the relationship between them and our office and all of our partners is solid and will continue.
Her supporters have said that, you know, she's on trial and that they're trying to attack a black female progressive prosecutor. What can you say to that, at least to the merits of this case? Does it have anything to do with politics?
On this case or any pending case, and I want your listeners to understand why. You know, everyone accused of a crime is presumed innocent.
Right.
And everyone has a right to a fair trial. And there's, you know, laws and professional conduct guidelines that rightly prevent me from saying or commenting on a pending case because there's a potential for, you know, unfair influence, and that it would be wrong of me to do that. We'll do our talking about any case in the courtroom.
Can I just have one follow-up to that? And it's not about the case particular, but it is just that they have asked that this go to trial before the primary, which is in June. Is that a possibility? What about the timeline of making your case in a courtroom?
With any case, you know, once there's a criminal information or an indictment, the parties get with the court and they determine an appropriate schedule.
And I
don't think that has happened yet in the case you're asking about, but that's the process.
You know, I understand U.S. Attorney Barron, having been through this a bunch of times, the nature of your answers, I completely understand. But U.S. Attorney Barron, when it comes to our local law enforcement, police department, we know that Commissioner Michael Harrison has asked for an additional 100 federal partners, whether it's U.S. Marshals or others. Can you talk about at least what you know about how that, because we had him on the show recently, we're still in the process of getting that help because he doesn't have a lot of officers. Do you know anything about where that is and getting some help?
I know that the leadership at the Department of Justice in D.C. is aware of the request. I know that our federal congressional delegation has made a request as well and is actively pursuing it. That's that's about all I can say. And I'm certainly, supportive and backing up our federal partners and from our congressional delegation and working with Commissioner Harrison, who's doing an excellent job.
And what about the consent decree that where it sits now? Where do you look at that big picture? And how? I know you've only been in the office for a couple of years, but obviously you know Maryland very well, having served in the House of Delegates. I mean, where do you see the consent decree and what impact it can have on the police department here in Baltimore?
I think, from what I understand, the consent decree and its implementation, and what our police commissioner is doing with this consent decree, it's going very well. I think this pandemic has really been very challenging with respect to that, and just running any agency. But my understanding is things are going well. The commissioner is doing a great job in professionalizing the department and making sure that the city has quality policing.
United States Attorney joins us right now, Erek Barron, United States Attorney for the state of Maryland. You were a part of the Maryland Justice Reinvestment Coordinating Council, but also just the whole legislation. We've had former State Senator Bobby Zirkin on in the past talking about this, how we're arresting less people for nonviolent crimes. So just can you speak to the nature of people who, think that this is a lock-em-up type of policy? Your office and where we need to be focusing is on violent people, and that's kind of where we've been going for a while now, U.S. Attorney.
Right. That legislation, which was, so monumental and unique and was driven by, it was a bipartisan enterprise with expertise across the board. And, the whole intent is really let's save our beds and concentrate our efforts on those who are violent. That remains the case. I think that bill is there's been improvements since then over the years, but it's being implemented well, I believe. And at the end of the day, it's up to federal, state, and local law enforcement partners working with the community together that's going to get a handle on crime in the city and elsewhere.
Well, good to have you on. We appreciate you coming on the show very much.
Let me ask one more question before I let the U.S. Attorney go. U.S. Attorney, let me ask you just one more thing, because one of the things I've spoken with your predecessors in the past about the issue of fentanyl and its role in the opioid crisis, that we had more people overdose nationally in the last year, but also here in Maryland, and the focus that your office has on dealing with the opioid crisis, U.S. Attorney.
Sure, and this is another important issue that I worked on in the legislature with House Speaker Adrian Jones and the governor's office. And at the U.S. Attorney's office, the office continues to work to address the opioid epidemic. It's continued unabated through this pandemic, through this COVID-19 pandemic. The numbers are just, have skyrocketed.
It's crazy.
Since 2019, and I think to 2020, we had a 20% increase in deaths, mostly caused by fentanyl. You're right, C4. The majority of our narcotics prosecutions now involve fentanyl. We think the most effective way to combat that problem is by focusing on the major traffickers. And so we're trying to, just disrupt the supply of opioids, particularly fentanyl, that are flooding our streets. And so we're also investigating opioid overdose deaths that are connected with major traffickers. And where possible, we're bringing these cases and, we're holding these people accountable. It's a big problem.
It's huge. United States Attorney Erek Barron, first time on the show. We look forward to having you back, and we'll talk with you in the future.
Looking forward to be back. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you on.
United States Attorney Erek Barron from the state of Maryland. And we must pick a note here. Bryan tried his best.
we got some information. We got some information.
Yes, you did. You get an E for effort.
Of interest. We'll talk a little bit about that and talk about crime and what he had to say and, where the state of Baltimore is on crime today. And another story, unfortunately, that we have to talk about of an innocent person who was shot sitting in her home.
In her home.
It just never ends in Baltimore. We got that and get the reaction from you coming up next here on WBAL.